encourage all of us in this conversation today. You know, one of the biggest problems on gender equality, the Girls' Lunch was at the World Economic Forum in Davos, and the United States has dropped from 21st to 28th place in the, you know, in the World Economic Forum metrics. 21 to 28, like that sucks. And we're going backwards. Why are we going backwards? And we're going backwards because we've been admiring the problem. We're all talking about that there's a problem. We're all talking about that there's a problem. Women are having all these empowerment, you know, conversations. But number one, transformation will not happen without men. This is a we for we conversation. It's something that we collectively need to stand behind and push forward if we want to drive change. And we have to start creating toolkits for change and activating them into a step change with solutions, or we'll continue to go backwards. I just came from Rwanda. Rwanda is number six on the list. United States is 28. Just saying. So within our industry, you know, we hear a lot of conversation about gender equality. Where are we at? Where are we going? What are we going to do about it? And I think especially in the agency world, there is big opportunities. We don't have to just keep pushing forward where we've been, but we actually, with all of these leaders in this room and the passion and the purpose that we all have, I think we're unstoppable, especially with leadership like yours. So thank you for starting this conversation, and let's see what we're going to do and where we're going to go from here. Here's to you.
Fantastic. Thank you, Shelley. Well, first of all, thank you to my Ogilvy friends and family. We're clearly going to need a bigger girls' lounge for the next year, so give yourselves a shout out. First of all, this is a hugely important topic for me, cause for me. I stand on the shoulders of a dozen women who, without, I would not be here. From my very first job at Ogilvy in 1979 as a summer intern, all through, I worked for many of the first women, first woman who to run an Ogilvy office in the United States, first woman country manager in Thailand. Charlotte Beers and Shelley Lazarus have been my heroes, and so I would not even make it to the stage without all of them. So this is really a great honor. Before I introduce each of the panelists, I do want you to know that while it's been in a cause that's been very important to me my entire life, I was raised by my mother, and I credit my mother with everything I've been able to achieve. The fact is that this is a topic that seems to be, and particularly since I took over for Miles as CEO of Ogilvy, one that is maddening to people. You know, maddening because it's one of the top issues in the world, and it is wherever you go. I was astounded. I got to attend Davos for the first time this year, and there are panelists at Davos who've been talking about gender equality for over a decade, and you didn't know whether to be utterly depressed or hopeful, because there's just so much incongruity around progress and what's happening and what needs to happen and the pace of it. So one of the things, the panel and I all had a brief conversation, and we said we were going to be dispensing with platitudes and politeness. This is about accelerating change. As I think Shelley has said, gender equality is no laughing matter. And so we're all impatient, and I know from the people that I deal with every day, we're hugely impatient on this topic. So let me introduce my esteemed panel. Just to my right, Meredith Kopit-Levien is the Chief Revenue Officer for the New York Times Company, one of the most respected brands in the world, one of our great partners. She's responsible for generating all the advertising and subscription revenue and leadership of the global advertising, marketing, video, and live events at the New York Times Company. She was previously the Chief Revenue Officer at Forbes Media. She's a Henry Crown Fellow, co-chair of the New York Times Women's Network. And despite her busy schedule of running a business, entertaining clients, and all those things we all love about the business, she still chaperones all of her five-year-old son's school field trips, which I just think, having never been on a field trip, I think that's unbelievable. So welcome, Meredith. Kate Ward is from, she's the VP of International for Refinery 29, began her career as a sales executive at TVF International in London. Quick rise through the industry took her to the VP position at the Shine Network, where she held global business development and strategy roles. For Shine Network and Shine TV. She's today she oversees Refinery Refinery 29's international growth and expansion. Refinery 29 WPP has an investment in the company, and one that a business we're working more and more closely with a whole range of our clients. So she is based in London, and we're thrilled to have you. And then Melissa Barnes, who is the head of global brands for Twitter. I want you to know Lauren Cramsey taught me everything I know about Twitter, even though I'm building a following one person at a time. She oversees their global advertising partnerships, the largest group of marketers in the world. Before joining Twitter, she spent 11 years in the agency business. She was senior vice president at Fleischmann Hillard, leading their New York consumer digital team. So welcome, Melissa. And Shelley, you need no introduction. We saw an amazing presentation from a senior partner at EY at our worldwide board meeting. And it always impresses me that the best women who speak about the issues of gender equality are ones who are successfully running businesses and talk to you from a business point of view, not just a gender equality point of view. And you've had an amazing success story of being a CEO in the top of the research industry, starting all kinds of different businesses.
And
I'm told here, the one thing I'm told is you're the chief troublemaker throughout your career. So thank you, Shelley, and thank you for co-hosting this with us. This is great. So here's where I'd like to start. I'd like to go to each of the panel members with sort of a three-part question. I'll start, Meredith, with you. I really want to know, as candidly as you can tell us, what do you think the real state of the situation is in terms of whether you call it gender parity, gender equality, just representation in all aspects of our businesses, our world. What do you think is frustrating progress? I mean, what at the end of the day are the kind of big so whats that we all need to get our heads around? And then finally, what, if anything, makes you optimistic for change? Are you seeing anything that's going on now that you would say, do more of that, do it faster? So we'll start with you.
That's a big question. Good morning. And John and Shelley, thank you so much. And Team Ogilvy, thank you so much for having all of us. It's a privilege to be here. I will say, I'm not sure I'm going to do this in the right order, but as to the state of things, I've been working for like 23 or 24 years, and I've spent most of that time literally working, not doing many other things. And I do feel like in the last 2 years, the conversation around gender parity has reached a fervor that wasn't there before, or maybe I just wasn't as actively participating in it before, but it does feel to me like the conversation is happening in more places, is happening by more people, so many, many more folks are coming to it. There are diverse groups of people talking about it, and it's happening in more and more different kinds of forums than it was happening before. However, I expect others will echo this. There's still insufficient action happening, and I don't know if this is quite an answer to your question, but what I will say is, in the sum total of sort of my experiences of being a part of the conversation, the only things that I can point to where I can see that real progress is being made is where individual leaders, men, women, young, older, African-American, white, gay, straight, of all shapes, sizes, colors, et cetera, take action. And that means personally take action to say, I have a choice between all other things being equal, putting a woman in the job or a man in the job. My company has an insufficient number of women in leadership. I'm going to put the woman in the job, and so on and so forth down the line. So in the sum total of my experience, I would say very optimistic that many more are participating in the conversation, concerned that not enough action is being taken, and believe that what needs to happen is much, much more individual responsibility and personal action around the topic.
Terrific, terrific. And we're going to come back to this thing called action, because I just keep hearing it over and over, is that, you know, we have the right insights and we have the right ideas, but we just don't get them done. But Kate, would you build on any of that?
Yeah, absolutely. I think, am I on? Maybe not. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I think Refinery is a media business that talks to young women, women kind of predominantly 18 to 35. And what we see in the conversation that we're having with women every day is that they are the most powerful generation of women ever. They have more access to higher education, and in fact, that all those metrics suggest that there are more women in those positions than men. They are being better compensated. They have very, very high expectations, and that's grounded in a conversation that we're having as a mission-based media company for women. But it's also reflected, I think, as you said really eloquently, in lots of other sectors. I think when you look at this year, Justin Trudeau saying, why is 50% of my cabinet women because it's 2016, I think you've really crossed the mark in terms of expectation in politics. I think when you have a woman like Jennifer Lawrence talking about equal pay in Hollywood, I think this conversation is grown in terms of its sector. I think it's grown in terms of its power, and I think there's an expectation of change, especially for the young women that we think about and we talk to all the time. That said, of course, I think there's a long way to go. I think there's action required. And I think perhaps one area that we might want to think about more is understanding women's individual experiences, giving them the forums to share their story, to reflect the different challenges that they might face, the opportunities that they might see for change, and also, I think, allowing them to share with each other and involving men in that conversation. So I think, you know, lots of positive news and a continued nuance in our approach in terms of action, I think, is probably good looking
That's
forward.
That's great. So, Melissa, one assumes that all of the new age brands that have come onto the scene, and Twitter would be one of those, have got this right from the beginning.
Oh, right.
There are absolutely, you're the most progressive, balanced. Is that true?
No.
And we didn't even rehearse that.
I know. Yeah. No, I mean, there's been such a spotlight on the tech industry in general because, you know, Twitter has our peers in general. We when you look at number of women in the industry, but also number of women in leadership roles, there is a lot of work to be done. And it's, you know, I always say I work with the greatest guys, the nicest guys in the world. They're progressive, they're young. But I think, you know, we're still... There's still lack of awareness of all the different ways in which this hits us. And so it's not just women in leadership in roles and sort of hiring those women for those roles. It's also when you think about how you get promoted by doing your current job really well and then taking on other projects that are very important to the company and doing those as well. And you think about who you give those opportunities to, and I've sat in the room so many times and watched it just be flipped to the guy. And nobody think about the young woman who has potential, that if you give her something, she will prove herself and do a really great job in a different way. And so I see that every day. But I will say what I love is there's so much attention on this and so much attention on the tech industry specifically that our leadership, yes, they think it's the right thing to do, but they don't have a choice. They have to change this. Everyone is watching. And so that has been, especially in the last 2 years, I'd say, nice to see when we look at what we're really measuring and trying to do.
Right. And Shelley, I mean, you've built businesses, run big businesses, men and women. Just going back to where I started, obviously you're optimistic. You wouldn't have led many of the initiatives you have if you weren't. But what do you think are the most important barriers that just have to be busted to get action going, to get the goals accomplished that are seemingly so out of reach?
I think, first of all, this is becoming a really boring topic, truthfully. Like, I'm bored of this conversation because we keep, it's what we said, talking about it. Next year here, I hope we all start talking about some solutions that we've uncovered, because how many more conversations do we want to have about optimism or opportunity? Listen, everything's opportunistic. We have opportunities. We are strong, brave, bold Americans and, you know, global citizens of the world. We have every opportunity, but it's not going to happen. The pace we're going, at the trajectory we're going, it will take over 118 years to accomplish gender equality. Like, hello, are we patient people? I don't think so. We're not patient for 118 years. Couple of years, fine. So I hope next year we start talking about solution kits. And so in Davos last year, we curated 23 conversations on gender equality and where we're at. And, you know, it's dismal. It's not a good situation. And we started looking at where the problems exist. And there are problems. Let's pinpoint the problems, because you can't solve it if you can't dimensionalize it and start dealing with solutions. So we took gender equality, broke it into four buckets. The wage gap. Mark Benioff said it right. We're in a technology age. Push the damn button, figure out where the inequality is, and fix it. It cost him $3 million. Ouch, it pinched, it hurt. But he made a decision to move forward. The same thing, unconscious bias. How much more are we going to talk about unconscious bias? There is an issue. I mean, you got a male, you got a woman. We both have Harvard MBAs. We're both equally. What's going to happen? I've got unconscious bias, but I'm conscious about my unconscious bias. You got a guy, you got a girl, ultimately say, oh my God, the woman's going to have babies, or she's going to have to take care of the sick kids and take them to school. And so maybe I need someone that can travel all the time and work long hours, the guy. But what if we started saying we need a particular skill set, looking at the masculine and feminine, and I'm looking for a leader that's emotive and collaborative and visionary and team building and nurturing and caring, or I'm looking for someone linear and assertive. And you might choose different people that way. We have to start a new conversation and creating accountability around it. And then culture. Our culture sucks. I mean, how do you really expect to attract and retain the best talent, not the available talent, if you expect people to travel all the time and work late hours? You're going to have people opting out, for that, men and women, for that reason. So culture has to change. And the fourth is the visibility. Visibility for leadership like yours that is going to start putting new rules in place that create expectations, not things that we can say, well, I got a CDO, which is usually an African-American woman, by the way. I'm going to check this off my list and say, I'm now being conscious of my unconscious because I have a chief diversity officer. We have to look into these things and start sharing stories of success and why the table is better with diversity and why leadership at the top has to push it down and push it up and make it mix, you know, all around, and visibility for people making significant differences. I think we have to move there.
Mm-hmm. So can I, one of the things that I enjoy doing now is every meeting I go to, I watch, I do whatever I'm expected to do in the meeting, but I watch the dynamics in the meeting, right?
Yeah.
And every meeting I go to, I see an uncomfortable situation of the dynamic between men and women. Now, I'll just tell you, in the spirit of radical openness for Ogilvy, we've initiated for years programs of unconscious bias training. We've done more and more leadership assessments in terms of leadership behaviors and practices. And we spent 3.5 hours last week at our worldwide board meeting on it. And it is absolutely still true that our worldwide board is not fully represented on an equal basis between men and women. We're making progress, but still a long way to go. And yet, the behaviors, we could have stopped the meeting every 20 minutes. Mm-hmm. So just take something relatively simple around how do we deal with that? Mm-hmm. I mean, I can tell you, even as of last night, the experiences of feeling uncomfortable around some of these areas. I mean, what are we going to do about this? Stop every meeting every 15 minutes?
You know what I have done with the men that I work with, and even the women, is it goes both sides. One is that this will happen, and women walk out of the room, and they're pissed off because they experienced something. But what I don't always see is the women then go back to the men and say, hey, I don't know if you realize, but you interrupted me 10 times in that meeting.
Right, right.
Stop that.
Right.
And the other piece of it is that if you're witnessing it, I do think sometimes you have to find a way to sort of call it out and say, Shelley was going to finish her thought. Or, you know, Meredith, I think she said that earlier in the meeting. We maybe have a good idea. Two people have said it.
Yep.
You know, I think we have to say it. And what I've found is that, again, you know, men are working on this. And when you make them aware,
yep,
and you keep telling them, then they tend to be grateful that you've said something, because they're usually not aware.
And do you all think it's fair to put as much of the responsibility on women to confront how they feel about the way they are being either treated or how they feel they're being engaged in the normal course of business?
think there's different levels of activity. First of all, I don't think a woman or a man should. Gender equality is not a female issue. It's a social and economic issue. Let's just get that off the table. Mm-hmm. Barry Salzberg, the former chairman of Deloitte, we were giving keynote speeches together, and my speech was called Bring a Motion to the Boardroom, and his was called Rising the Ladder or something. And I say, he found me behind the stage, and he says, Shelley, I have to tell you some very exciting news. And I said, yeah, what's that? He said, we just hired our first female CEO for the United States. And I said, well, that's fantastic. Did you hire her to fill a quota or because you wanted the table to be better? And he said, let me tell you something. He said, I had 3 out of 34 women on my board. And he said, and they never spoke up. They were quiet and silent. And I said, so what'd you do? He says, I got rid of 5 guys. I added 5 more girls. There were 8 out of 34 now. I said, what happened? He said, all of a sudden, conversation started.
Right.
We stopped talking about the numbers and the linearity, and we started adding in the stories and the contextualization. And, you know, and so I think it's not about women talking too much and having to say, let me finish. That is a dynamic, but it's more just the style of how we roll.
Yeah.
And women are a little more, you know, inclusive and wanting to put more personality around numbers and frame it. And so it's just appreciating that you need both of these kinds of conversations at the table to really create the dimension and the complexity and then hopefully the simplicity around solving it, that we have to start talking about making it, it's a girl problem, it's a boy problem. You know, tomorrow we have a conversation called the flipping point because women are starting to have all these conversations and men are like, hey, what about me? Like, yeah. I didn't do anything wrong. And so
let me in.
It has to stop being the blame game of it's everyone's problem. Yeah. It's really understanding how we make, you know, business better ultimately with all of us together.
So what's life like at the New York Times?
In what context?
In the sense of what Shelley's talking about.
Terrific. So I want to sort of put a parenthesis around a particular point that Shelley's making. In my own experience at the Times, I have found that it is entirely about the table. Mm-hmm. So I have 9 direct reports. When I got to the Times, nearly all of my direct reports were men. Today, so on the team of 10 of us, which includes me, 5 women, 5 men. So I have hired 4, because I'm the 5th, 4 women who are my direct reports who lead, you know, major parts of the Times commercial business, one of whom was my chief of staff, but is being promoted to run a much larger portfolio of work. And I've been there for 3 years, and in the 3 years that I've been there, just seeing the difference in what comes from that table. So what you've got around this table of 10 is essentially the people running all of the commercial activities of the New York Times, the ways the Times makes money. And the way the conversation has changed, the nature of the conversation, the fact that we bring, there is more sort of story and emotion brought into it. There is also sort of a constant push to see that the things that are unfolding in a balanced way. And I feel great about that. And it's made me realize, again, the importance of individual action at sort of all levels of the company. I'll say 2 other things. Well, let me say 1 more thing about that very quickly. The last of those hires that I made, I was 9 steps down a 10-step path to hire a man as an open senior vice president of sales role at the Times, which is a massive, massive job. You run basically half the revenue in the United States in advertising for the Times. And I was about to hire a man, and in the 11th and a half hour, a woman came to the table. And she was unbelievably qualified for the job. Literally, the only issue is I was sort of further down the path with the man, and I had a moment with myself where I said, again, like, given the choice, I know gender parity, gender and leadership is a massive problem at the Times. I'm just gonna, you know, sort of throw a wrench in the process, and I'm gonna hire the woman, and it was the best decision I ever made. And it actually ultimately balanced out my table. So that is good. I wanna say it is not all a pretty picture at the Times. We have an executive committee of 12 people. And depending on how you define it, in some constructions of the definition, I'm the only woman on the executive committee. That is very, I think that I work with wonderful male colleagues who are exceedingly supportive and collaborative. But as I think about the women coming up in the organization and the men and people of color, they look around and they do not see a sufficiently diverse leadership team. And they can't not ask themselves, does that mean this company is not for me? Right. So that is something I think about all the time. Say two other quick things about it. A lot of the really, really good things that are happening at the Times right now in terms of action, some of them start from the top. Even more of them start from the bottom. So I'm the executive sponsor of the Women's Network at the Times, which just means I show up and make sure they have sufficient funding and just ear of leadership to make things happen. The leaders of that network, not me, the young women leaders of that network, it just so happened there were four of them. They all were having babies at the same time. They came to me and they said, our parental leave policy stinks. We are competing with Twitter and Facebook and Google for talent, and we have a parental leave policy that was basically invented for law firms that didn't have women 40 years ago. So it stinks, and we have to fix it, and we personally feel this. And they brought a proposal, and they did all the work, and they did all the research, and I basically just got to sponsor the bill, and I walked around and got Mark Thompson and Arthur Sulzberger and Michael Golden and a group of men in their late 50s and early 60s to say, hey, this is really important. We want women in our 30s. We need to change this. And we changed it. So good things happened from
That's
the
fantastic.
Ground up.
That's fantastic. So, Kate, what I want to ask you is a company founded by men for women, right? Do I have that right?
You have that half right.
Okay.
So we actually have four co-founders, and two of them are women. So Philip and Justin are co-founders and co-CEOs, and
right.
Piera is our executive creative director, and Christine is our global editor-in-chief. So at Refinery, we have four co-founders, parity amongst those co-founders.
Yep.
I think there are the two points, because I guess the question, which I get a lot, is how can a company founded by men be dedicated?
Well, I was actually going to ask you even a more progressive view, which is, are you designing the company in the spirit of what Meredith is describing, which is you're focused on practices, policies, governance that ensures this kind of balance?
I think at Refinery we're we probably have a different problem to or a different set of challenges to some of the other businesses. In that we are more women than men in our organization. So though we have four co-founders, our chief creative officer, chief people officer, chief revenue officer, head of sales, head of international are all women. All of those, you know, a lot of senior women in our organization are mothers, amongst the many of our C-suite. So we're really incredibly lucky. We have incredible role models, sponsors, mentors, advocates. And we are also really lucky because we have a highly engaged, committed, dedicated senior team of men who are also dedicated both to women's progress in our organization and in terms of the content that we make and what we put out there to the rest of the world. Do we still have to work at systems to support, engage, and further women in our organization? Absolutely we do. In part because the experiences of women, even in an organization that has lots of senior women, are still relevant. So to Meredith's point, what we see is there are some things that we do that come from the top. There are some things we do that bubble up from below. So we had a staff actually started women's mothers group. It started literally as I believe it started as an email chain of new mums talking to each other about what it was like. That's now become a more formal group that's sponsored, that has lunches, that has funding to meet and talk and share. And it's really important. On the other side, coming from a policy perspective, you know, maternity leave. We have a really progressive maternity and paternity package at Refinery. One of the key things I think is really interesting about our maternity paternity leave is that actually men also enjoy paid paternity leave at Refinery 29. often what that means is that our male employees are getting more paid paternity leave than their wives and girlfriends. What that means is that they can go home and share in that childcare, support their partners, support their wives in that capacity. Yep. So I think that kind of thing is really important and really progressive. So I think we're lucky in lots of ways. But again, there still has to be action taken from employees and from management.
Yep, yep. Can I, before, because I have a feeling people will want to ask a lot of questions from the audience, can I do just two or three subjects in a quick drive-by?
Sure.
If I think back on what enabled me to take over as in leading Ogilvy, I would say the leadership of the company just always being engaged and explaining to me a path. So they didn't say, oh, you're going to be CEO one day. They said, well, you should go to Thailand and do this, or you should go over and do that, or you might fail over here. That'll be okay, but you'll do something else. No one ever said to me, what's your family life like? You know, what's your responsibility to your wife and children? And it ultimately in my career became a terrible dilemma in terms of getting that balance right, which I did not. How do you have that conversation today in terms of wanting to give someone a long-term view of their opportunities, putting them into stretch assignments? Shelley Lazarus made this comment last week at a conference we held, Women Inspiring Women, that always say yes. Right, because the big opportunities, you know, they may feel like you're not ready, too hard, but it's often the best stepping stone into the next big opportunity. How do you have that conversation today with the highest potential men and women?
It was interesting when I was hiring for my team. I was looking for global leads who were running Coca-Cola, P&G. These people travel the world. It's a honey of a job. It's a great job. When I would find somebody interesting, the first thing you do is you ask your network, do you know this person? Are they good? What do you think of them? And for every woman that had kids, the first thing that people would say when I'd ask them about, say, Emily, was, well, she has kids. And I'd say, okay, but stop. I don't care. She's put her name forward. She seems qualified. How is she? For the men, it never came up. And I have three men on my team who have kids. It was one of those things where I actually went to our leadership team and said, this keeps coming up and people need to just stop focusing on it. If a woman puts herself forward and thinks she can do it, we can't make judgments based on where she's at. It's when a woman's pregnant, then it's out there and it's much more explicit. But sometimes I still see decisions or assumptions made that we don't have a right to make.
But your view is never assume.
Never assume.
And then figure out what the workarounds may or may not be.
And then still push those women that are having kids. And every woman that I've worked with that is going into that stage, we have that conversation and really talk through scenarios. And then it's up to her and her family to decide what they want to do.
All right. Shelley?
I actually think that, one of the things that I've always done is led in a way that I wanted to be led. And so just because we're women doesn't give us the justification to say we know best. It's being in a position of leadership, whether it's a man or a woman, that pushes their organization to be the best that they could be, because everyone wants a life with dementia. It's not just moms. I mean, I'm a mother of three children, a 19, 21, 24, and I've had to do it all my way, without perfection, because I've been willing to accept that imperfection is perfection. And when I became a leader, I said, I never want to follow the rules that made no sense for me. And I always had to figure out how to break them, quietly. Now I broke them publicly, because they're just dumb. And we have to open it up and sensationalize the problem. Like, why do I have to stay until midnight to keep my lights on? Because that's what everyone else is doing, and I'm not going to get ahead. That's just stupid. I was inefficient. I wasn't doing anything. I was, like, sitting here pushing my papers from side to side. Like, that's ridiculous. Or, like, I'm missing my kid's soccer game or hockey game. So I started negotiating with my colleagues, even when I had no permission. I wasn't a CEO. I said, listen, I need to go to my kid's soccer game now so that you could go on your date tomorrow night, because you shouldn't wait until you're 70 to get married. That's just silly. I'm not going to wait until I'm 50 to have kids, and I'm not going to wait until 70 because I don't have time to go on a date because I'm working so damn hard. And, at the end of the day, what happens? You lose your job, and then you say, shit, I missed all these soccer games or hockey games or great dates or, and So I always lived my life with an expression called no regrets.
Yep.
No regrets.
That's correct.
And what I always did at any age, from the age of 23, I'm now 54, and I still live with no regrets, where I would say to myself, will I feel bad if I miss my kids' play or their soccer game or my husband's dinner party with his boring doctor friends? You know, would I miss? And if the answer is yes, I'm going to miss it, I wouldn't do it.
Right.
And I'd find a workaround. And I was just as successful, by the way, later in life than doing those two extra meetings that I would not remember today, but I would remember, and so would my kids, that I missed that important event.
Yep.
And so, and I said, if I'm not going to feel bad, then go.
Right.
But I always ask my question. And then when I had a company of 250 employees, the biggest problem with leaders is they don't walk the talk.
Yep. Yep.
They say, oh, we don't want you to work past 11 o'clock at night, but then you get an email at
where
midnight
are you?
And like, you know, fuck that. Like, that's not fair.
Lauren,
you know?
That doesn't happen to you, does it?
Right. Yeah, so never. I think you have to, you know, lead with generosity and give your company permission, or team, we all have teams, to live the life that you want to live, and expect the same of yourself as them, and then we'll make progress.
Yep.
I just have one quick little anecdote to share that relates to what both Melissa and Shelley said. So I agree with Shelley. It isn't just moms. It's men and women who have care responsibilities and want to have dimensionality to their life, and the workplace needs to support that. So I had a baby at 40, and it was like a long, hard process to get there. And I was the publisher of Forbes at the time, and I have a very progressive husband who sent me back to work, or I went back to work at 5 weeks, and I will never forget this. I am leaving to go back to work, and I'll tell everybody it was a huge mistake to only take 5 weeks maternity leave. State of the business at the time at Forbes, sort of important that I go back. And I'm literally leaving that first day, and that day you go back after maternity leave, no matter who you are, is like a miserable, emotionally intense thing. And I'm walking out the door, and my husband said, love you, bye, don't talk about the baby. And I was like, right, don't talk about the baby. And literally, like, my CEO executive husband was like, you work on an executive team of all men, like, they don't want to hear about the baby. And like, even in my own goddamn home, the unconscious bias of, like, of, you know, to the, my partner in life, the man I love the most in the world besides my son, said this to me. And I was like, he's right, don't talk about the baby. And you know what? I didn't talk about the goddamn baby. And you know what? I got to the New York Times, and you know why I told you I go on field trips? All I do is talk about the baby. Yeah. At the New York Times, the baby is now 5. But it's not a baby anymore. But the point is, like, if you don't model, and I'm not perfect at it, and I work too much, but
you're perfect, you know, Meredith. I think you're perfect.
If I have to be somewhere for my son, if I skip breakfast with Arthur Sulzberger because I have a parent-teacher conference, or I tell Mark Thompson, sorry, I know that meeting goes at 5 o'clock, but I can't be there because I need to be somewhere to see. I am so public about it because I want everybody to see it has to be done that way. It's not always babies. It's not always kids. Sometimes it's parents or spouses or whatever. Yeah. People need dimensionality
that
in their lives.
That starts a new conversation.
Yeah.
Like, by doing that, by going and now talking about your babies, then other people will start talking about their babies versus it be this silent taboo.
Secret.
Like, it's like, I'm not supposed to. So do it. And if you do it, then everyone else is going to do it. But if you don't do it, no one else will.
And I think also what we're seeing here really is like an emergence of a new type of leadership. Mm-hmm. You know, empathetic leadership that puts individuals' experiences, their nuances, challenges, and, you know, things that we all have to deal with, the shit that we all have to deal with, and allows those things to be aired irrespective of gender. Yeah. I think it's really important, and I think, you know, empathy is probably a word that doesn't get used enough in terms of this conversation.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, first of all, to the entire panel, thank you so very much.
Thank you.
This is...